Good morning, PL team. This is Piyush Nagda, and we are good to go for the webinar. We have Mr. Ketan Shah, Managing Director of Pronesis Capital with us, and also Mr. Rahul Choksi, he is Vice President in the operational side of the Pronesis Capital. Just to give a brief background, Ketan Shah has spent more than 20 years in debt markets. And now he has started his own company sometime back called Pronesis Capital, and it has become a leading player in debt markets in a very short span of time. And we thought that this is a right time where many of PL clients also, you know, keep inquiring about bonds and, you know, the debt market instruments. So we thought that let us introduce Mr. Ketan Shah's company, Pronesis Capital, and also give a brief rundown on how the bond markets are working and what are the current opportunities in the market. So I think Ketan Bhai and Rahul Shah, we are now good to go. So over to Ketan Bhai for taking us through the opportunities in bond market. Ketan Bhai, the dais is all yours.
Thank you. Thank you, Piyush Bhai. And hello, everybody. My name is Ketan Shah, and I started my career in year 91-92. I think it was Harshad Mehta's boom period. I started as an equity in the equity market. So from 1992 till now. So now, you know, we'll be covering now today about the debt market. So debt market is, you know, very, very important and critical component of any financial system of any economy. I also started my career in the year 92-93 in equity outright system. And all of you are from equity market, so you are very much aware about how equity market has evolved over the last so many years. It was like, you know, equity market was totally open outcry system. Now all of us are doing a screen-based trading. It was physical shares to demat shares. Brokerage level were 1-2%. From there to now, you know, people are talking about zero brokerage and all that thing. Similarly, debt market also has evolved over last so many years. Debt market, you know, that time in year 92-93 or over the last 20 years, it has evolved. Earlier days, mein debt market, there were very few bonds were available. Like it was issued by leading companies like Reliance, Tata Group, Tata Motor, Tata Steel, Reliance Petroleum, all that. They were used to issue, I think if you are, any of you are very old in the system, they will be knowing that they were used to all issue partly convertible debenture, fully convertible debenture. So partly convertible debenture out of say 100 rupees face value, 50 rupees will be converted into equity at subsequent dates. And 50 rupees will be retained with the investor as a khokha portion. That was what we called as an NCD now in today's market. So that was a kind of a bond which I traded at that point of time. And over a period of time, from very, very selective markets where very few deals were taking place, very few participants were there. So from now to it has become a full institutional market. Still to retail level, it has not reached fully. In the year 1991-92, when Manmohan Singh government started liberalization process, and they immediately understood that need of vibrant equity as well as debt market is very much essential to fulfill the need of large amount of money required to fund any projects like infra projects or for even private corporates also. So from that time, you know, debt markets development started. Debt market, various committees were formed by the government, which has partially helped to develop the debt market. And over a period of time, the terminology, the calculation of return on the bonds, everything changed. Like I remember in previous year of from 90s, like 90s to 2000, we were used to calculate the return of any bond by means of a current yield. Current yield means coupon of the bond divided by price. So So that was the only methodology applied for calculating the return. But then subsequently, in line with the global market, you know, this time value of money concept came into picture, and then now we are calculating what is called as a IRR or internal rate of return, or what we called as a yield, which we will cover up subsequently, all the jargons and all the terminology of the debt market. Now, for any country, a well-developed bond market is very essential for any economic development, and also to withstand any shock or any financial crisis. Now, how the debt market has developed over a period of time, that you can see by only AUM data of mutual fund. The debt funds were in, say, probably around 98-99, the debt fund were below 1 lakh crore put together in the industry. Whereas now we are talking about in the range of 12 to 14 lakh crore. Of course, world over, debt markets are much, much larger than equity markets and very well developed, where they have a market for all the bonds like AAA to even junk bond. And they have now credit default swaps also, all the you know, various products are available. But our market has comparatively developed very slow. It is relatively illiquid market. Like our market, if you see, then domestic debt market is around 67% of GDP of India. And corporate bond market is only 16% of GDP compared to probably 45 to 75% of any other developed market. And USA, it is much, much more larger. So this is what is the brief situation of the Indian debt market. Now, debt market provides, what is debt market? Debt market provides a return commensurate to your risk-taking ability, your preference for liquidity and safety, and relatively lower volatility vis-a-vis equity market. Hence, debt market provides a lot of potential. But here today, we would like to, you know, make everybody understand that there is a general concept or general thinking in India that debt market are safe and there is no loss which can come to any investor. So I think we would like to throw some light on that also today while we go through our presentation. So this was just a brief understanding of how the debt market has evolved over a period of last 20 years in India. So now, what is the bond? So by theoretical definition, bond is a instrument which will provide any investor the fixed coupon which is assured in that bond, and it will be of some maturity, right? And see, now we will see if you can see your screen. So there we have mentioned the various instruments which are present in the market today. One is short-term instrument, which are of less than 1 year, which includes certificate of deposit, which are normally issued by the banks. Their commercial papers are issued by corporate. It are rated by the rating agency, and these are unsecured instrument. Then treasury bill, everybody knows that these are issued by Government of India. So this is the normal government enterprise. So risk is minimum or zero there. Then long-term bond, which are more than 1 year bond, which include category of government bond SLR, which is government security. And then state development loans, that every state of India, they issue to run their finances, their bonds, which are called state development bonds. Then we have non-government bond. These are of private, non-government bond. So in non-government, we have three categories. One is public sector bond, which are taxable or tax-free. So like public sector enterprise, like Power Finance, REC, IRFC, Power Grid Corporation, and many more, like all PSUs category. Then bank bonds. Bank bond includes all the banking bonds, which are of two category. One is perpetual bonds, which we everybody is aware because we have heard a lot of about perpetual bond and risk associated with the perpetual bond now in recent past. So perpetual bonds and another bonds are actually which are tier 2 bond. These are of tier 2 capital and tier 2 bonds of all the banks. So banks includes all public sector bank, all private sector bank. And then comes last category, which is private companies bond. So private companies also, there will be two kind of bonds, which will be, one will be of public issue, which normally come by a public issue mode. And most of the bonds are of private placement. So I think in Indian market, almost you can say 80 to 90% issuances are of private placement in nature. Now, if you see ratings, so ratings are, rating are, one is sovereign, that is with any paper which is issued by Government of India is having a sovereign rating. Then it comes AAA, then AA plus, then AA, AA minus, A plus, A, A minus, and then it comes BBB plus, which is just an investment grade, which normally you know, people would like and avoid. Only the fund who are who has this expertise to invest in this kind of instrument and take that risk, and the investor who want to take that risk, they only go for BBB plus and investment grade kind of a bond. Instruments, I mean, this our slide shows that how the bond market composition in today's scenario. If you see total size of bond market, this figures are latest of April 2020. It is around 127 lakh crore. And if you see, the major component is borrowing by Government of India, that is government securities. Then 24% is by state. So you see 45 plus 24 plus 3% of T-bill. So almost around majority of borrowing by is by Government of India. And then comes corporate bond, which is around 24%. Commercial paper is around 3% of the total outstanding debt market of India. And CDs, that is certificate of deposit, that is around 1%. So this is how is the broad composition of existing debt instrument in India debt market. You can probably just see the slide. So total it is mentioned, all the amount is mentioned there. This slide shows the how the debt market has evolved over last so many years in India. If you see the AUM of all the mutual fund of debt category, it has steadily increased over so many years, and probably last 5 years, 6 years, I would like to mention that it has developed dramatically. Market has become matured, and it has developed more for a credit also, because up till now, till probably 5-7 years back, credit fund were not much in flavor. People were not ready to take much risk there. So, but now if you see the AUM of all credit fund also, so that has also gone up substantially. And of course, as a byproduct of any lending, we have seen some defaults also in that category, and investor has faced a problem also in that area. And other chart is of Indian debt, Indian central government debt and corporate debt. So that shows the how over a period of time, issuances and size of market has grown. So it has significant rise in government and corporate debt and mutual fund debt in last past two decades. This is just to give you a brief idea that how Indian bond market has also developed over a period of time. Now we will talk about terminology and things which is everybody should be aware while when you are investing in a bond. So first is coupon. So coupon is the yield or percentage, say any bond, say State Bank of India perpetual bond having coupon of 8.75. So that 8.75 will be paid to the investor during the year. So coupon is the amount or interest which a corporate entity or a bond issuer is promising to pay to the investor. But understand, there is a difference between the coupon and the yield at which you are buying. Now, say once this State Bank of India has issued a bond which is of 8.75 coupon, and see, if you are not subscribed in the primary market, then when you buy from the secondary market, if you buy, say, at a yield of 8.50, see, coupon was 8.75, and if you buy at a yield of 8.50, that means you have paid some premium to buy that bond, right? So there is a difference between coupon and yield. Normally, I think still we come across investor who understand that when they buy a bond, so coupon which they have bought, so they are going to get that much. But no, it is not the case like that. It will be less if you are buying at a premium, and it will be more than coupon if you are buying at a discount to that. Now, another second terminology is maturity date. So maturity date means on which date you are going to get your principal back. So that is called maturity date. So maturity date can vary from 1 year to, in Indian dot market, we have bond up to 30 years maturity, right? Then next is put and call option. So that is a structuring. This is a structuring means it has a put and call option, means investor has an option to get out of that bond at that date. So that is called put option. And call option means that option is available to the issuer to repay or prepay that money on that debt. There will be always be a record date, like how you have record date in equity market for dividend. So there is always a record date of around 15 to 30 days. So during that period, if investor want that money, so they have to send notice to the issuer that I want my money back. And if issuer want to get that money back, so they will send notice to the investor that, okay, we are prepaying this amount. Now, third is face value. Face value means bond, what is the minimum denomination of the bond? So that is face value. Face value now ranges from 10,000 to 10 lakh, and very few bonds are 1 crore, but otherwise 10 lakh is the normal face value of the bond which we come across in today's market. And 1 lakh is also now face value, which is very common, because now retail debt market has also developed over a period of time. Then coupon payment frequency. So how you have in your fixed deposit, that is how here bonds are also having various coupon payment frequency. Normally, majority of bonds are either annually paid or semi-annually paid. That is, once in a year, coupon payment is called annual payment. And semi-annual means it is paid twice in a year. And similarly, you have quarterly coupon also and monthly coupon also. So that all depend on the terms and condition of the issuer. Then fifth is ISIN number. ISIN number is how you have equity market. Every bond series by any issuer will be having ISIN number. Now six will be rating and rating agency. We have already seen in the previous slide that how the rating goes from AAA to BBB plus. AAA is the highest rated and BBB plus is the investment grade. And rating agencies. So rating agencies are, as we all are aware, that CRISIL, ICRA, then India Rating, which is held by Fitch. Then you have a CARE rating agency. Then we have a Brickwork. And then one rating agency which is not much known in the market is SMERA. SMERA is there for rating of all SME and MSME. So it is more popular among that, and they cater to that segment only. Now, seventh is whether bond are secured or unsecured. So now, as per latest SEBI guideline, mostly nobody can issue unsecured NCD. But in past, we were having secured and unsecured both category of debt instrument. So secured are normally bonds which are secured by some fixed asset, and normally security cover here in bond market is around 1 to 1.25 times of your principal amount. And unsecured means, of course, that are totally unsecured, and bondholder will have a last claim on the issuer if anything wrong happened to the issuer. And last is discount or premium. So it is very important for any investor of debt market, or even if when you you approach to any of your investor with bond, So whether we are buying a bond at a discount or a premium, here this become very important, because when it comes to perpetual bond, so whether you buy at a discount or premium is very critical, because we have seen in past that public sector banks, when they were put under PCA guideline, that is when they were put under PCA, so that time RBI directed couple of banks like IDBI Bank, Corporation Bank, then Indian Bank, to buy back their bonds from the market prematurely. Like by one notification, they bought back all the bonds outstanding from the market. So now what happened if we have bought at a premium, say Corporation Bank bond, say which coupon was say around 9%, and you bought at a yield of 8.50. So that means you have paid a premium for that. So if any banks comes and buy back in between, so then you will lose out your premium. So this is very, very important parameter when we buy any perpetual bond of any banks. So this is the last terminology, whether we buy at a discount or a premium. Now this slide shows what is the advantage of buying a bond over FD, that is Fixed Deposit of India. Now fixed deposit, say State Bank of India, fixed deposit rate right now is probably around 5.5 to 5.75 for 3 to 5 year kind of a maturity. Whereas State Bank of India perpetual bond, which is having call option in year say 22 or 23, or 24, in the year 22, 23 or 24. So around 2 year or 4 year maturity. So that is available at a rate of 9%. So now you can see the clear advantage which any investor will have to invest in State Bank of India perpetual bond. Because FD rate for 3 year is around 5.75, whereas State Bank of India perpetual bond will fetch you probably around 8.75 to 9% kind of a yield right now in current market. Similarly, vis-a-vis, you have all the banks ka perpetual bond, like Union Bank of India. Union Bank of India bond, perpetual bond probably will be available in current market at around 9.75. Whereas Union Bank FD will be again around 5.75, 6 or 6.5. So there is a clear difference in the rate. Why this difference in the rate? This difference in the rate is the risk premium which these bonds are offering you, because these are not FDs, these are perpetual bond, and all of us know what is the risk in the perpetual bond, because in recent past we have seen that in Yes Bank perpetual bond all the bonds were written off when banks come to a deep trouble. So that is why investment in very sound bank is very essential, and your advisor, or if you are also acting as the advisor, it is very essential that we advise the right bond to the investor, so that we try and minimize the risk for the investor. Clear advantage of bonds over FD is that bonds offer higher yield. And this yield also keeps on fluctuating in the secondary market. So it is not necessary that if you have bought today, say SBI bond at a yield of say 9%. So tomorrow or going forward in 1 year time, this rate might vary from 9 to 9.25 also, 9.5 also, or it can come down to 8.75 also, 8.5 also. So like in equity market, you are going to make some gain on your purchase price, or you can lose also on your purchase price if you come for sell in the secondary market subsequently. If you are a long-term investor and if you are going to hold till the tenure of the bond, the return which at which you have invested is going to accrue to you. Another advantage in bond is that you can invest in a lump sum amount. Like if a bond is having say face value of 1 lakh rupees, so like in a multiple of 1 lakh you can invest, and say you have invested say 25 lakh rupees in State Bank of India perpetual bond. Now its face value is say 1 lakh. So even if during the tenure of the bond, if you say in between you want some 5 lakh rupees, so then 5 bond you can sell it off in the secondary market. So partial exit is possible in tranches. And the last advantage, fourth is very important, is there is no TDS on this. So any bond in private sector or public sector, there is no TDS applicable. So whatever is the coupon, it is going to accrue to you fully without any tax deduction. And you have to take care of tax aspect in your annual income tax return. So this slide also shows that how the rates vary. So you get almost around say present market around 3% advantage, which is very substantial. And it across the spectrum, all public sector bank bonds are available now. Mainly large three bank, that is State Bank of India, Punjab National Bank, and Bank of Baroda and Union Banks. Four banks bonds are available in the market. And they offer a fantastic spread over your fixed deposit rate. But of course, what you are compromising here, you are compromising because it is a perpetual bond. And by very nature, if tomorrow Government of India says that this bank is going down and we are not going to pay, so then your that money has gone. So that is the risk which you are running. So that is why one has to take a very conscious call that where I will invest and which bond we will invest, because these are three main premier banks of India owned by Government of India. So we know what risk we are taking, right? And you have a private sector perpetual bond also, like I will mention few just for understanding, that ICICI Bank bonds in present market is available at probably around 10% kind of a rate. Because what has happened in recent past with the equity market and credit crisis, which is going on right now, and the after Yes Bank episode, ICICI Bank perpetual bonds are also available at a 10%. Axis Bank are also available at a 10% kind of rate. Then once you go still low, say Karnataka Bank, Karur Vysya Bank, so that bonds are available at a yield of probably around 12%. And one more notch down, that is South Indian Bank. That bonds are available at a rate of around 13%. But one has to understand that what risk we are taking. So it is very essential from advisor point of view that when we approach, we have to understand the client risk profile. If he is ready to take the risk, then only one should recommend. Otherwise, in present market, probably what we recommend is that all public sector bank bonds, and probably ICICI Bank and Axis Bank, that we feel relatively they are also safe. There is no issue there because all are having a call option in the year 22 and 23, and some are having call option in 21 also. So you are investing for 1-3 years, and we don't foresee much issue with any of this bond. Now I will here I will give one example that just before this Yes Bank episode happened, IndusInd Bank perpetual bond were traded in the market at around 9.75 to 10% yield. Immediately after Yes Bank episode happened, now the yields in this IndusInd Bank bond has shoot up to around 13 to 14%. So as we know, you all are from equity. So market, equity market, or I mean market knows everything very well, and they discount everything immediately. And then subsequently when crisis is over, so then boys will be differentiated from men. So again, I think probably ICICI Bank bond, which is available today at 10% rate. So probably probably 3 months, 6 months down the line, again, their rate might come down to 9%. State Bank of India, which is available at 9%, it will go down to 8% also. So that all depend on market and how market condition will evolve, and how the liquidity parameter, and of course RBI's rate action, everything also has to be taken into account. Next slide.
Yeah, just to add one more point. Now here, we have highlighted an analysis of FD, bank FD over their bonds, but also understand that this will also transit to corporate FDs also. So a lot of corporate FDs are significantly lower than, you know, what their bonds are being traded, corporate FDs, NBFC FDs, they are significantly lower than what their bonds are trading in the secondary market. So whereas here the spreads are probably 3-4%, there the spread will be much larger. So anybody who is willing to put an FD in a high rated NBFC, if that person is okay to have that exposure, then he will fetch a significantly larger yield, higher yield, when he's buying the bond in the secondary market. And there it is not even probably a perpetual bond. There it can be a clear cut secured or unsecured bond. So that option is also over.
Yeah. So I think as Rahul has said, you know, this public sector bond, which we feel are really good, it offers a good investment opportunity in present market scenario. Because in past, there are incidents where government of India has stepped in, and when there was, see here, the basic clause of any perpetual bond is that whenever their capital adequacy goes below the regulatory requirement, they can't pay this bond. And as it has happened in a Yes Bank, your entire amount can be written off also. So in past, we have seen incidents. There was an incident when IDBI Bank, there was a interest payment was due and there was a call option also. So that time the capital adequacy of IDBI Bank was at a you know, brink of breaching that norms. So immediately government of India stepped in, they paid the interest. I mean, they made the bank to pay the interest and buy back all the bonds. So they, I mean, so we can take past experience into account, and we can say that, you know, public sector banks bond of perpetual bonds are relatively safe and it offers a very good investment opportunity. But of course, this disclaimer is always there that you are buying a perpetual bond. So you must know what is this bond, what is the nature of this bond and what risk. Now this is the KYC for any investor, that before buying a bond, or before, if you are a wealth advisor or if you are a RM in wealth, so we should first question ourselves that what are the steps we should take, or we should know, or we should do a real KYC check of our client, and then only we should recommend. So these are the KYC check for anybody before investing in, even not in perpetual bond, any bond to that extent. First is, what is the risk appetite? So what is my risk appetite? If my risk appetite is, say, I would say if it is a zero risk appetite, then I should buy only normal secured bond of Government of India enterprise, like Power Finance, Rural Electrification, Power Grid Corporation, Indian Railway Finance, IRFC, or maybe Food Corporation of India, or NABARD, or CDB, that kind of bond only I should venture. If I have a little more risk appetite, then as I have told you, we can buy bank bond. Now, bank bond also available is, one is lower tier two, and another is this perpetual bond. So as in the Yes Bank case, all investor who had invested in tier two bond of Yes Bank, they all are safe. Now their bonds are converted into this new Yes Bank bonds, and everything has been serviced very properly and on timely. So there is no loss to that investor. And there's a bank bonds are available in two categories. One is tier two and another is perpetual. So if my risk appetite permits me, then I have to venture into perpetual bond. Then what is my return expectation? So here, of course, that return expectation is definitely are two sides of a coin, that my risk appetite and return expectation goes side by side. So if my return expectation is high, then I have a variety of bond available with me. Not even bank bond. There are private corporate bonds also available, like Tata Group, Aditya Birla Group, and whole lot of corporate, Reliance Group, whole lot of corporate is available. And then third question, what is my time horizon for investment? Because Indian debt market, even in today's scenario, is relatively illiquid. Because here there is no hedging available, there is no short selling of bonds is there, So relatively Indian debt markets are illiquid. So what is my time horizon for which I am investing? And for that is why, you know, if you are not very sure that, okay, I am investing for 3 years, but I may need money after 1 year or 2 years. I mean, there could be a need. So then you should invest in a liquid bond. What is liquid bonds? So then liquid bonds as a bond like AAA bond or this State Bank of India perpetual bond, these are relatively liquid. Like even if you want to sell, you can approach your broker or wealth advisor, and probably in a couple of days, they'll be able to knock it off and give you the proceedings. I mean, you'll be able to get your money back. Then awareness about debt market. So as I said before, that it is not necessary that debt market means there is 100% safety. There is always a risk element. And this risk element is that price risk you'll be carrying. Like how you buy any equity, today you bought Reliance. Okay, you have bought Reliance with the horizon of 3 years that I will remain invested. But if you have a rate of say 1100 and tomorrow rate goes to 900, so that mark to market risk you are carrying. So similar funda is applicable to debt market also, that any bond which you buy, you are subject to mark to market gain or loss in that bond. Now, what is the investment as a size of total corpus? So that every individual has to define that depending upon their risk appetite. And then what coupon, like if any senior citizen, they want a bond which are of monthly coupon so that there is a regular inflow to them, then you have to pick and choose that kind of bond. And then you have to define your what pre and post-tax return which you are looking at. So based on that, if you are in high tax bracket, then you can look for tax-free bond also. So debt market, like equity market, so many times provide a tremendous opportunity because debt market is predominantly an institutional market. So institutional market, if there is a fund flow mismatch or there is a redemption pressure in the mutual fund industry, so then they will come to sell the bonds. How is the situation today? So then lot of bonds are available at a very good price, like State Bank of India bond, which I told you, which is a perpetual bond, which is available at 9%. Just before 1 month or 1.5 months, this bond were traded at a rate of 7.75 to 8% kind of a range. So now, even after RBI has come up with a reduction of 75 basis point rate cut, still these bonds are high, available at a higher rate. So why? Why? Because market situation is like that. There is a liquidity requirement by the seller. So they have to dump the bonds. So whoever has a appetite, they can grab this opportunity. I would put it this, this is an opportunity in the market. Now we will try and define some risk here, that what are the risks which any bondholder carry. As I told you, general perception is, that bond markets are risk-free, and probably mis-selling also happens in the market. That bond market are totally risk-free. So whenever there is such event which happens, so then investor will get, shock of their life that, okay, oh, I'm losing money here. I thought this is a bond, so I'm not going to lose any money. So no, it is not like that. So we'll just define key risks here. One is price risk. So as I told you, price risk is the risk which you carry, how you carry in the equity market, that when you buy a bond, at a yield of say today you buy State Bank of India bond at 9%. So it might happen that if this current tight liquidity situation continues for some say couple of months more, then this rate might be sell in the market at 9.25 also, 9.5 rate also. In March, I can tell you, in March we traded this State Bank of India bond at even 10% also. So from 10% it has come down to 9% now. So now again, it can go back to 9.25 also, 9.5 also, that nobody knows. It will depend on the technicals of the market. But fundamentally, these bonds are a buy bond. Fundamentally, the risk which any investor is carrying is limited, which we feel. So price risk is the risk which you will carry. Like see, if you buy today at 9% and in the 6 month time, you come to sell in the secondary market. And if that time rate is 9.5, So then you are going to incur a loss, because here price and yield are inversely proportional. So if yield goes up, your price goes down. So say State Bank of India, say at a rate of 9%, so at a 9% rate, you have bought at a rate of say 100 rupees. So tomorrow, after 6 months, if you go to sell at a 9.5, when rate is 9.5, when you go to sell, then there will be a depreciation in your price. So your 100 rupees might become 99 at that point of time. So that price risk you are taking. So every investor should be fully aware that you are taking a price risk. So your return will accrue only and only if you remain invested for entire period of that debenture or bond. Then what is credit risk? Credit risk, of course, as explained to you, what kind of bond you are buying. So depending on the bond category or bond rating and bond issuer profile, that risk you are carrying. So as I explained to you, State Bank of India is a low risk. Then ICICI Bank is also relatively low risk, but little higher than State Bank of India. Then if you go to Karur Vysya Bank or South Indian Bank, so your risk goes on. Similarly, there are a lot of corporate bonds. Like there are bonds in the market of Tata Steel also available, Tata Power also available, Aditya Birla Group available, Bajaj Finance available, then Mahindra and Mahindra Finance available. And there is a whole lot of structured product is also available, probably probably retail investor or HNI investor also would not like to take probably. But there is a whole variety of bond available in the market. I would like to give you a small data here that probably around Indian corporate debt market has more than around 13,000 bond of maturity more than 1 year. So you have a wide range of menu card here available for debt market, in the debt market for bond. So that is credit risk. So like credit risk, even there are investors who buy distressed asset, they have bought Vodafone bond also, which is traded probably right now at around 20, 25, 30% also. So they have bought. And even after Dewan Housing has gone into NCLT now, still there are distressed asset buyer who buy this bond at some price. So everything depends on credit risk, which you are ready to take. And third is liquidity risk. As I told you right from the beginning that Indian debt market is not very, very liquid. So whenever you are buying a bond, you should clearly define your timeline. If you feel that you might need this money in between, then you should always invest in a liquid bond. And your advisor will be able to advise you which are liquid bond, which you want, you will be able to sell in between if it is required. So that was liquidity risk. Then how your, which are the other risks? See, these are the risks, which is price risk, credit risk, and liquidity risk. Which are the other risks? Then any your investment will be subject to a couple of more risks also. One will be RBI action. As we all are aware, RBI, time and again, do monetary action. Every quarterly, we have a monetary policy given by RBI. So based on this RBI action, prices of any bonds will go up or down. Then crude price, all of us are aware that crude is a very big parameter in equity market also, debt market also. So if crude prices goes up, then naturally, inflation goes up and RBI will not be able to cut rate very dramatically, or their hands will be tied by this thing. So crude price also has a lot of bearing on any bond. Then inflation is the most important parameter of debt market, that based on inflation figure only RBI actions are taken. So inflation is a very key parameter which one has to monitor whenever you are investing in any Indian bond. Then currency movement, of course currency movement always has some bearing on any bonds. But I think in the Indian context, probably it is not that dramatic. It is only more of a sentimental value. But of course, currency movement always has threat of that if there is currency, if our Indian currency appreciate or depreciate very dramatically, then RBI may have to come out with some action. So that may again impact your price at which you have bought. Sold. And then credit event. Of course, credit event like Dewan Housing, IL&FS. If the bond which you invested, if it goes bust, then your money is gone. And the last is secondary market. So secondary market, as I told again and again, that secondary market is shallow. So whenever you buy a bond and if you want to liquidate it, there will always be some kind of liquidity risk. So if you are planning to buy bond money today, so it might happen that your arranger will be able to sell it in a 2-3 days time. So, I mean, it all depends on you have to be in touch with good advisor who can guide you properly. Are some bond category which we have defined that as corporate bonds are mainly divided into two categories. That is, one is offering by public sector enterprises like as I already told, IRFC, NHAI, NABARD, your PFC, RSEs, and how they are defined, that we have just put it here just for understanding. The tax-free bond of IRFC, which is having maturity 26 March 2019, so principal will be paid on 26 March 2029 back. Face value is 10 lakh rupees, rating is AAA, and current level tax free return they fetch in the range of 5 to 5.5. similarly, NHAI also has a tax free bond, NABARD also has a tax free bond, and then taxable bonds, as we already mentioned, the State Bank of India, here they have a various call option 22, 23, 24. So depending upon your investment horizon, you can pick and choose. And likewise, so on and so forth, there are various kind of bonds available, which you know your advisor will be able to share you. And sector-wise also, we have just try and explain that which are the bonds available sector-wise, like NBFC sector, Bajaj Finance, Sundaram Finance, Chola Finance, Tata Capital, Mahindra & Mahindra Finance. Then you have a, if you have a high risk appetite, then you have a lot of other NBFCs also available, like Shriram Transport. Then you have AU Small Finance Bank. A lot of small finance banks are available. And there are a lot of new entrants in the NBFC sector. So that all, again, depend on your risk appetite. Power sector, like Tata Power, Torrent Power, they kind of are available. Among the metal sector, Tata Steel and Vedanta's bonds are available. Among auto sector, Tata Motors, Mahindra are available, and so on, like real estate. You have bonds of DLF, Oberoi Realty, Godrej Property, Kotak Patil, Tata Realty and Infrastructure. Among the retail segment, Reliance Jio bonds are available. DMart, that is Avenue Supermarket, that is also available. Nirma is available. Bharti Airtel, SB Cards bonds are also available. And among PSU category, all as we already defined, BPCL, HPCL, PFC, RSE, IOC, ONGC, all bonds are available.
So going ahead now, what has RBI done now? RBI's whole objective right now is to see to it that the present crisis does not translate into financial market crisis. Now, as we all know that, you know, before this COVID-19, we were already fighting with low growth and limited headroom from government to kind of jumpstart the economy. So, on happening of this crisis, lot of owners came onto RBI so that they do something so that the economy doesn't go into a deep dive. So beyond the 75 basis point rate cut, you know, RBI has taken various measures with the sole objective of not only to inject liquidity, but also to see that those liquidity percolates to private sector.
Rahul, your voice is cracking.
Yeah, can you hear me now? Better?
Better.
Yeah, sorry. So, one of the first steps which, you know, RBI did was injecting liquidity. Now, it it was already doing it from February policy, where it had introduced something called as an NTRO. Now, NTRO was injecting 1 lakh crore into the system, and the money would be available to banks at that point of time at the policy rate, which was then at 5.15. This was solely again so that, you know, banks start deploying them to private sector. That they have taken it one step forward, wherein they have not only increased the LTRO amount from 1 lakh to 2 lakh, but they also done a CRR cut. Now, what CRR means is that every bank has to put 4% of the deposit that they give, that they get, with RBI. So, as in, if supposedly you have an FD of 100 rupees with SBI, so of that 100 rupees, 4 rupees have to be kept under CRR, which is cash reserve ratio, with RBI. Now, this is the money which is locked with the RBI and which does not yield any interest to the bank. Now, as a sign to give more liquidity in the hands of the bank, what they have done is reduce the amount from 4%, the percentage from 4% to 3%. Now, while it may seem like a very small change of 1%, but this 1% reduction translates into 1,35,000 crores of liquidity in the hands of the bank. So that is a huge quantum of money which is there with the bank incremental for them to start lending out. Second was the LTRO, and third is another facility called as a marginal standing facility. This is slightly a technical one, but on a simplistic scale, it means that this is a facility wherein they can park their investment in Government of India security with RBI and borrow money against them. So that limit has also been increased. So this entire activity has been done so that there is additional liquidity in the hands of the bank. Second step which they took was a reduction in cost of borrowing. Now, this is the paramount thing which they did, so that a lot of money gets transited to the sectors which require them at a lower cost of borrowing. What happens is that right now we are into a marginal facility wherein the marginal cost of borrowing is a variable cost of borrowing. It is a function of bank's ultimate borrowing cost. If bank's borrowing cost is brought down from 5.15 to 4.4%, it will indirectly transit to practically all the borrowing which is done by private sector, which is done by retail sector, and which is linked to this rate. So this is one more, you know, initiative that RBI has taken by reducing the repo rate so that the cost of borrowing of the industry comes down. And third thing what RBI saw was, despite banks having a lot of liquidity, a lot of money wasn't going out to the private sector. These monies were flowing back to the RBI and were getting parked as an ideal one-day money. Now, just to incentivize banks to lend, what RBI did was they reduced the interest on the money that they were getting or that the banks were passing. So say suppose SBI has 100 rupees extra to lend out, but probably it will not have a comfort in the present market scenario to who to lend, whom to lend. So what we will do, it will park that 100 rupees with RBI and get 4.9% interest rate on that. Now, RBI did reduce that percentage also. So when SBI is now getting only 4% annually on that 100 rupees which is passed with RBI, so now SBI or any bank will think that rather than parking money at such a lower rate, let me start lending out at least to the blue chip of the market, the corporate, top corporate of the market, the top PSUs of the market, which will at least fetch me my lending cost. So that is something which RBI did, wherein although they cut repo rate by 75 basis points, they cut reverse repo rate by 90 basis points. So that banks are incentivized to lend outside and not to park it with RBI. Second, what it did was it introduced targeted long-term repo operation. Now, what it means is that earlier repo operations which were there, wherein there was no timeline. As in, you know, even though banks would borrow, there was a timeline for them to kind of, you know, deploy their money. However, in this targeted NTRO, they have a timeline within which they have to start deploying their money. Probably they can buy commercial papers from the market, they can buy corporate bonds from the market, but they have their induced banks so that they can, they will actually start lending it out and not again park it with RBI. So all these three policy actions which they have taken is one, to inject liquidity, and two, to push liquidity into the system. Now, why it becomes essential? Because when liquidity goes into the system, a lot of NPA problems, at least for time being, get averted. A lot of credit risk, at least for time being, gets averted. Now, when all these actions are taken, what is the impact and outlook for the market? Now, as we all broadly know, that government is also into an overdrive wherein it will be spending more to revive the economy. The growth will be lower, so it will have its impact on the tax collection. When you spend more and when you are having a lower tax collection, the direct implication is market borrowing, wherein they have to come to market more often to borrow. Just to quote a number, in the budget that came out in February, they had given a number of 780,000 crores to be borrowed from government of, from debt market. This number is widely expected to be significantly higher because the expected tax collection will be lower and the expected expenditure will be higher. So because of this scenario, what we have seen is, despite there was a rate cut, the yields of Government of India bonds went up. So Government of India bonds have gone up. However, because of this same scenario wherein the liquidity is there and banks will be incentivized to push in money, a lot of cheap money is available with the banks, and this money will go to credit which are of good nature. So in nutshell, as Ketan sir said, that these are times where, you know, because of distortion, because of market compulsion, because of redemption flows, outflows, there has been pressure and yields of good corporates, AAA corporates, corporates with long history of good business, good governance, their yields have also gone up in the market.
I'll just interrupt you for a moment. Here, I think some people are not able to hear your voice properly. So I think we are left with 5-10 minutes. So yeah. I'll just this three parameter which you told right now.
Yeah, sure.
Because I think your voice was cracking. Okay. So in short, if I summarize this, which Rahul has said, so in current market, unprecedented market situation, RBI came out with a slew of measures, as you have seen already seen in your news in CNBC, that they have injected liquidity by reducing CRR. So CRR is the amount which every bank has to keep with the RBI as a safety norms. So they have reduced by 1%. So that unleashed a lot of liquidity with the bank to lend further. Now, what happens, that bank will again, a lot of public sector bank, they remain in silos and they don't lend to anybody. So for that, to compel them to lend, they have done this long-term repo operation. So what they have said, the RBI said, you take money from me at say 4%, and then you buy, say State Bank of India. State Bank of India will go to RBI. They will borrow 10,000 crore from RBI at 4%. Then RBI says, okay, you have borrowed from me 10%. You have borrowed from me 10,000 crore at 4%. Now you invest 50% in the secondary bond market, buy bond from the secondary market 50%. And 50% you invest in primary market. That is compulsory. And they have been given a timeline of 1 month to invest that. So what RBI has done, they have provided liquidity to the bank, as well as they have said that they have compelled them to buy bonds from the market. So how Federal Reserve themselves is doing right now in USA, they are buying all the lot of assets from the market. So that is what RBI has done indirectly through their public sector bank channels. That not only public sector, private sector also can borrow and then buy. And that is what has happened in the market. Probably in last 1 week time after these measures have come into picture, almost all bank put together must have bought almost around 7,000 to 8,000 crore worth of secondary market bond in public sector enterprise bond. And that's why their yields have gone down almost around 1%. So this is a liquidity measure. Then as they cut the repo rate, so repo rate is cut by 75 bips. So normally, so every, your entire, you know, all the levels will come down because repo rate is an indicator of your benchmark rate. So if that is low, 4.4, so naturally, State Bank of India, if you see, they have reduced the FD rate also. So every rate will come down. So basically, they are making borrowing and interest rate regime very low interest rate regime. And as last point says, incentivize bank to lend. So sharper reduction of reverse repo. See, they have reduced reverse repo to straight 4%. So they are saying, don't put money with RBI, you go and lend in the market. That is what they want to see. And they want to do almost around 1 lakh crore of long-term repo operation. So by that, they are giving liquidity to the banks and compelling them to invest in the bonds. Now, of course, that investment decision lies with the bank's investment committee where to invest that. But sooner or later, I feel that, you know, they will guide them to buy even private sector bond also, right? So this is in a nutshell that RBI has done a lot of things to reduce the rate, to provide ample liquidity, and to channelize that liquidity in the market, in the hands of various participants. Still, I think more action will be required, or more action also we may see in times to come. And overall, as Rahul was saying, that market looks that government security rate might go up. So that are all function of market. If government comes and borrow very large amount from the market, then government security 10-year government benchmark rate will remain elevated. Whereas if government of India decide to do some innovative structure and monetize their fiscal deficit and not to borrow from the market or to borrow from international market, then yields may go down. But overall, I feel, you know, rates are due to go down only. There will be temporary up and down, it might happen. But overall interest rate scenario, what they are trying to do is to bring it down substantially.
Okay.
Right?
Yeah. So I think, now we just have around 5 minutes left. And it was a great session. Actually, debt markets are otherwise a very complex subject, and you really made it very simple. And I am sure that actually with all the good information you gave, a lot of our RMs are, you know, thinking about the perpetual bonds, especially the SBI one, which you talked about, which is available at say 9% yield. And a lot of people have requested us to share the list of good, you know, instruments which you had shared earlier. So which we will definitely do next week. And I'm getting some couple of questions. So before we wind up, we can take around two or three small questions.
Definitely.
So one of the interesting question, one of the our RMs is asking is that the interest rates versus the yields are inversely related. So generally, you know, how do you see the GSEC market going forward in this scenario?
No, so as Rahul has said right now, the GSEC market probably all depend on the government borrowing program. So with this kind of unprecedented crisis which has happened right now, so naturally government earlier there was a government was trying and follow the fiscal FRBM. They were trying to strictly follow the FRBM, and their borrowing was restricted. But now they have to give a lot of stimulus. To revive the industry, to revive the growth, and a lot of money has been given to a lot of poor class also. So So that all has come as an unexpected money. So now fiscal deficit is going to widen substantially, which is a phenomena world over. It is not now confined to India. So for some point, I mean, for next, I think 1 or 2 year, fiscal deficit, nobody is going to look at it. But only thing, how you are going to borrow that money. See, ultimately, government either has to get that money from taxes, or they have to borrow that money from the market,
right,
to fund that requirement, to give stimulus also to the industry, right? So somewhere they have to buy. So how they are going to approach this matter, that is very critical. There are a lot of options has been discussed right now, that there may be some innovative way they may resort to. If that happens, then government security yield will go down. But otherwise this rates 10-year benchmark will remain little elevated for some time.
Okay, great. So one of the participants is asking a question that in last some days we have seen some negative returns on low or short duration debt funds.
Right.
So do you see this to be continuing till what time?
No. I think, see, that was why it has happened, that in the March, last week of March, there was a tremendous liquidity crisis. See, here again, the action which taken by RBI was little late actually, because all market participants, they approached them from almost beginning of the market, that there's a system is very deficit of liquidity. So you have to do something to give that liquidity. So what has happened during that time, all these short-term instrument, which were of 10 or 3 month or 4 month, of which normally typically any liquid fund or short-term fund buys up to 1 year maturity paper, right, their rates went up by almost 1.5 percentage point up, even percentage in some cases. So naturally, then your liquid fund is going to give you negative return for that period of time. But again, after that RBI action, now rate has come down even lower than what was previously.
Right.
So now I think in next 15-20 days time, the return will smooth out actually.
Great. So the this last
is one of kind of phenomena which we have seen.
Great. So the last question before the session ends, should one have a 5-year view to invest in bonds or a triple rated NCD? How you take this time horizon question? Shall someone have 5-year view or less than that is also?
Yeah, I think, see, as I told in my session also, that all depend on your individual need. If you have a requirement to invest in a 5-year tenor, then of course you can definitely invest in triple NCD. But as I said, it will always be subject to rate fluctuation.
Right.
Because you will not be able to time the market.
Very correct.
Yeah.
So I think we are in the last minute of the session, and I again thank you a lot, Ketan bhai and Rahul bhai from Team Forensics Capital, for giving you valuable time and really making this subject so interesting for all of us. And I again thank all the participants also for giving their precious time on Saturday. And we hope to continue this next session also on debt markets once we get the feedback of all our participants, because a lot of education and knowledge will help us to position this product to all our clients also. So thank you. Thanks again, Ketan bhai.
Thank you
for inviting us.
Yeah. Thank you all the participants. We'll be closing the session in a minute.